Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. In this series of reflections of Hajj, or the pilgrimage, it reminds me of a time when I had recently embraced Islam. I was 23 years old, and I embraced Islam just a little bit before September 11th. So within the time period when I became Muslim, my girlfriend at that time actually embraced Islam a week later, and we got married a month later. And then my father, a couple of months later, embraced Islam. We were invited to the house of Allah literally within like 6 months or 7 months of us becoming Muslim. And it reminds me of a time when it was a great challenge for Muslims all over the world because of the unfortunate incidents of September 11th that did not portray the beauty of this religion. But because of our wanting to explain to the American public what Islam had done for us, it had led us to speak, especially in the Spanish language, to so many churches and so many different public spaces, even universities, that one of the people of knowledge that was living here, who was actually from Riyadh, from Saudi Arabia, he was working with the consulate, he said that a prince of Saudi Arabia wanted to invite my wife and my father, who had recently become Muslim, and myself for the Hajj, for pilgrimage. And it was amazing for us to even think that we could go that fast, because there were so many people that we knew that were born in Islam or had been Muslim a lot longer than us and had never had the opportunity to perform the pilgrimage. And I remember getting on the plane thinking that we weren't ready because we were new to Islam. But the sense of wanting to go to a place where we were, you know, facing that direction to pray, it was amazing. And my father was 57 years old at that time. And we know that the greatest struggle that the woman goes through is Hajj. So when we got off the plane, I didn't really even know where we were going to stay. But to my surprise, we stayed at the Hyatt Regency. We stayed at some of the best hotels in the closest perimeter or closest range to Al-Haram in Mecca and in Medina. We were given a bracelet, and we were actually having been invited to the kingdom, basically. And I remembered of Hajj from Malcolm X, because he was there as a guest as well. And it reminded me that, you know, only somebody who has been invited by Allah Azza wa Jal can end up there. And in these circumstances, people like us who spoke the Spanish language, we saw very little people from Latin American countries. And I was thinking, how is it that there are so many different flags from so many different places, but you don't see flags from Latin America? How few of people from our lands who speak our language, you know, are in a place where all over the world people are going to worship one God? That led me to think, why can't it be a day when people go over there and they have flags from different Latin American countries? My father had a pain in one of his heels, and we didn't know if he could actually walk all the distance. And I remember going downstairs, back in those days, 2002, you had to go downstairs for to get the Zamzam water. It's not like that nowadays, but that's how it was. And I remember going down there, and my dad was limping, and I told him, you know, there was a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that said that Zamzam, you know, if you make dua and basically use Zamzam, you know, your dua is accepted. And I took some of the water, and I not only did my father drink, say Bismillah and drink, but he also used it with his hand. You know, he said it in the name of Allah, and he put it over his heel, and he made dua for Allah to allow him to walk in Hajj, which is a long distance. And subhanAllah, it was one of the miracles, I think, that we saw as new Muslims, how all of a sudden my father was healed and he was able to walk without any limp and without any pain. When you're in Mecca, you realize the power of that place. You realize that you're no longer in control. And one of the first things that hits you is the fact that you see the Kaaba, this place that was built by Abraham and Ismail. May Allah be pleased with them. When you see this place, I remember it was like, it's like the air was thin. Even though there were so many people, it was quiet. even though people are walking barefooted, it's like you don't even hear footsteps. I mean, I remember acknowledging the fact that there's birds you hear, they sound so far away, but they don't dirty the Kaaba. You know, they don't even sit on top of it. You know, birds usually sit on top of a place. It's almost like they would come and leave. This place was unlike any place. But as we got into the tawaf, you know, the going around the Kaaba, and as we got more into the different stages of Hajj, we realized that you lose control. And one of the things that happened to me personally as a son is that my father at 57 years old, we couldn't find him. He got lost in the multitude of people. And I ended up getting on a Tahoe with some people from the Ministry of Hajj, and we were looking for him. Luckily, alhamdulillah, we ended up coming back to wherever we were in that stage of Hajj, and he had made it back. But you start realizing that Allah will test you with that which you love. And in the midst of so many people, you know, the days of the Jamarat back in those days is not like now. People would get trampled, you know, on. And so you start realizing that you could lose somebody. You know, my wife and I had to, you know, lock up. And she was 21 years old. So for her, the struggle, right, we knew was the greatest struggle, you know, as it is for women, Hajj, the greatest struggle for a woman. But Allah made it easy. We were in so many different places that because we were guests, I mean, in places like Mina, we had water, we had tea, we saw people roughing it out. So I think that first Hajj for us was so much easier than the other times that we went. But the reflections of places like Muzdalifa, for example, I remember seeing everybody laying down on top of the ground. And I looked and I said, one day, everybody will be on the ground, will be going back to the ground, but not above, but below. It allows you to reflect and think. You know, from the third floor of Al-Haram in Mecca, I could look down and see if Allah gathered so many people in such a busy world, how easy is it going to be for Allah to resurrect everybody and gather them on the Day of Judgment? Reading the Quran in that place was unlike any time that I've ever read the Quran. It's as if Allah spoke to you directly. Going to the lands where the Prophet ﷺ had been in Medina, realizing the sweetness of being able to go by and just see that not only do you give salam where he's buried, but the sweetness of Medina led me to understand that the sweetness of Zamzam, the sweetness of Iman, faith, knowledge, came from these lands. And it really motivated me to come back and continue learning, alhamdulillah. And with these reflections, I remember that there was nothing like that first experience. And on these days of Dhul Hijjah, I ask Allah Azza wa Jal that if you've never been there, that you make the intention to go, because only Allah can call you. And I'm grateful that Allah called me. And when we came back, we had the intent based on a dua. And I'll end with this. I made one dua in Al-Multazim, the place where the door is. And I remember tears coming down when I made this dua. And I said, oh Allah, guide me and guide my family to be able to take this message back to the people where we came from, meaning people who speak Spanish or people who grew up here in these neighborhoods in America. And don't make us the excuse for people to say, because of that individual being that way, I don't want to be Muslim. Meaning I want to be an example for the representation of this deen. And alhamdulillah, soon thereafter, when we came back, we started Islam in Spanish. And it's a vehicle that we're still transmitting this information through. So may Allah Azza wa Jalla accept from each and every one of us. And we hope, inshallah, you end up in Allah's house being called. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.